Hello once again, everybody. I'm Jeff, and welcome to the Gridiron. This week, we want to take a look back at the year of 1950. 1950 was the 31st regular season in the history of the National Football League. And also 1950, just as well as 1960, the week I covered, the year I covered last week, 1950 was an extremely important year in the history of professional football. Please, let me explain. From 1946 to 1949, 4 years, there was the All-American Football Conference, or another football league. 1946, it had 8 teams. By 1949, they were down to 7, and all 7 teams were basically pretty much losing money. So after 4 years, the league disbanded. But for the players of the All-American Football Conference, it was good news. 3 of the teams, the Baltimore Colts, San Francisco 49ers, and the Cleveland Browns, all got absorbed into the NFL. Other players from the other teams of the All-American Football Conference were put into the draft, like with the college players. So if anybody was any good, they would get drafted by the NFL players. So it wasn't like they disbanded and nobody got to play football anymore. 3 full teams got pulled into the NFL. And by the way, 1948, I know it's no big deal, especially to the Miami Dolphins fans, 1948, the Cleveland Browns had a perfect season. They were 14-0, and they won the league's championship game. So they had a perfect season as well. Okay, 1949, the NFL consisted of 10 teams. During the 1950 season, obviously, they went up to 13-team league. The Baltimore Colts were kind of like pretty much a roller coaster ride. It was like a soap opera. Yeah, you had just kind of follow. It was like tune in, today to see what was going to go on. They were a pathetic team. I believe they were 1949. They won like one game in the All-American Football Conference. They got absorbed into the NFL. And in 1950, they lost. At that time, they played 7 preseason games. They lost all 7 of them. They lost their first 6 regular season games. And week 7, they finally beat the Green Bay Packers, score 41-21. And that was to be the only victory the Baltimore Colts would have during the 1950 season. They were losing money, and they went under after the 5th season. The owner sold the team back to the NFL, and Colts, I believe, were 1-11. And then if you consider they lost their 7 preseason games, they were 1-18 for the 1950 season. Absolutely pathetic. However, the San Francisco 49ers and the Cleveland Browns did do much better. Also, in 1950, the Los Angeles Rams were the first team to get television rights. They broadcasted all of their home and away games. Shortly after that, the Washington Redskins would soon follow. But the one downfall to it was that with the Rams, they noticed that their home attendance started dwindling. I believe it was about half of what it was the year before. So the following year, they went back to just televising only their away games, blacking out their home games, so therefore their attendance could go back up. So in 1950, the commissioner of the league at the time, Burt Bell, absorbed the 3 teams from the All-American Football Conference into the NFL. Now, the Cleveland Browns were obviously the cream of the crop. The Browns won all 4 All-American Football Conference titles from 46 to 49. Definitely far and away the best team in that league. So when Burt Bell got a hold of the schedule, he scheduled the Philadelphia Eagles and the Cleveland Browns to play in week 1 of the 1950 season. Now, why was this important? Well, the Eagles won a little roll of themselves. The Eagles won the previous 3 NFL championship games. 1947, the Eagles lost to the Chicago Cardinals. Yes, the Cardinals actually won an NFL championship. Cardinals prevailed 28-21. 1948, in a blinding snowstorm. Oh, this is football at its finest, folks. The Cleveland The Philadelphia Eagles beat the Chicago Cardinals by a score of 7-0 in an absolute blizzard. Oh, what football. And in 1949, the Philadelphia Eagles beat the Los Angeles Rams by a score of 14-0. So the Eagles won a little bit of a roll on their own. They would host the week one game against the Cleveland Browns. And in Philadelphia, there was a crowd of over 71,000 people to see the game between the Cleveland Browns and the Philadelphia Eagles. Probably pretty much anybody, fans of the NFL, certainly the commissioner of the NFL, Bert Bell, thought that the Eagles would reign supreme. But it was not meant to be. Cleveland Browns rolled all over the Philadelphia Eagles by a score of 35-14. So in 1950, the NFL consisted of two conferences, the American Conference and the National Conference. The American Conference had only six teams in it. The six teams were the Cleveland Browns, Philadelphia Eagles, New York Giants, the Washington Redskins, the Pittsburgh Steelers, and the Chicago Cardinals. The National Football Conference thus consisted of seven teams. Those seven teams included the New York Yanks, the Green Bay Packers, the Chicago Bears, the Detroit Lions, the Los Angeles Rams, the San Francisco 49ers, and the Baltimore Colts. Now, I'll tell you what, defense was certainly at a premium. There was scoring all over the NFL. It was a 12-game season. The Los Angeles Rams had such a powerful offense that they scored over 40 points in six out of their 12 ball games. In a Week 6 contest, the Los Angeles Rams beat the Baltimore Colts 70-27. The next week, the Los Angeles Rams beat the Detroit Lions 65-24. Can you imagine that, scoring 135 points in two consecutive games? That's absolutely phenomenal. The New York Giants had an up and down year, I mean, as far as scoring points, but in a four-game span, they scored 50 points three times. But in the end, in the American Conference, the Cleveland Browns had a record of 10-2. So did the New York Giants, which forced a playoff, a game which was played in Cleveland, and the Browns would wind up winning by a score of 8-3. And over in the National Conference, the Los Angeles Rams and the Chicago Bears would both finish the season with records of 9-3. So they had to play a playoff game to see who was going to go to the championship. And a game played in Los Angeles, the Rams would prevail by a score of 24-14, thus setting up the NFL Championship in 1950 game between the Cleveland Browns and the Los Angeles Rams. The 1950 NFL Championship game was played in Cleveland, Ohio, in front of a crowd of only 29,000 people at Cleveland's Municipal Stadium. And for the people who showed up to see the game, what an incredible football game indeed they did see. On the first play from scrimmage, Bob Waterfield hit Glenn Davis on an 82-yard touchdown pass, giving the Rams a 7-0 lead. Well, within 3 minutes, Otto Graham completed a 27-yard touchdown pass for the Cleveland Browns, knotting the score at 7. But before the quarter would end, the Los Angeles Rams would drive 81 yards in 8 plays and score another touchdown, giving them a 14-7 lead. But midway through the second quarter, Dante Labelli would grab a 37-yard touchdown pass from Otto Graham for the Cleveland Browns. He would run in for the touchdown, but on the point after try, the snap was fumbled. The Browns never got the kickoff, and they trailed 14-13. And that would be the score at halftime, 14-13 in favor of the Rams. But within 4 minutes of the third quarter, Dante Labelli and Otto Graham were at it once again. They connected on a 39-yard touchdown pass. The extra point would be good, giving the Browns a 20-14 lead. But the Rams, on the ensuing kickoff, would have a drive of their own. They would drive down to the Cleveland 17-yard line. And there, they would give the ball to the fullback, Dick Horner, 7 times in a row. The last time he had the ball, it was fourth down and goal to go from the 1 yard line. He would smash his way into the end zone, giving the Rams a 21-20 lead. But on the first play after the kickoff, Hall of Famer Marion Motley would fumble the ball deep in his own territory. Larry Brink would scoop the ball up for the Rams and run it in for a touchdown. The Rams' second touchdown within 21 seconds, giving them a lead of 28-20. But the Cleveland Brown defense, thankfully, would start to tighten up a little bit. But the score being 28-20 meant that the Browns were down by two scores. But late in the third quarter, Bob Waterfield would throw an interception. The Browns would get the ball at their own 35-yard line. Otto Graham would lead his team to a touchdown drive, going 65 yards, completing 9 passes, 5 in a row to Dante LaBelli. Can you imagine that? Throwing the ball 5 times in a row, completing them all the same guy. You'd think they'd double cover him after a while. But once the Browns scored that touchdown early in the fourth quarter, having the Rams with a 28-27 lead, the Rams defense started to tighten up. And most of the fourth quarter, the Browns and the Rams traded punts back and forth, until the Browns got the ball back with about 2 minutes left to go. After a Rams punt, the Browns started the ball at their own 32-yard line with about 2 minutes left to go, giving Otto Graham and the Cleveland Browns a chance to drive down and kick the game-winning field goal. On the first play, Otto Graham kept the ball himself, ran for 19 yards. The next play, he completed a pass for 10 yards. The next pass that Graham would throw would fall incomplete. However, the next two plays would complete passes and get the ball down to the Rams' 11-yard line. The next play, Otto Graham would sneak the ball to the center of the field with 28 seconds left, giving the Hall of Fame Cleveland Brown kicker, Lou Groza, a chance to kick the game-winning field goal. So with 28 seconds left to go, and when the ball got snapped, the ball was placed down at the 16-yard line. Lou Groza would split the uprights, giving the Browns a field goal, and thus the 1950 NFL Championship. What a phenomenal game indeed it was. Both teams had over 400 yards of offense. Absolutely amazing. Both teams combined for about 600 yards passing. What a phenomenal, phenomenal football game indeed it was. One for the ages, that's for sure. Well, that's all the time I have for this week. What year we're going to visit next week? Well, you're going to have to come back and see now, won't you? Come back and visit me. Well, that's all the time I got for this week. Thanks for watching once again. I'm Jeff. Remember, I'm going to see you on the gridiron.